on Actor Z with Budd Friedman.
Brett, how are you?
Good, good to see you, Bud. Good to see you, Bud. Good to see you. It took me 15 years and tearing the door off my car to get an interview with you. Thanks everybody for waiting. I'd literally gotten an accident outside, but that is comedy, isn't it?
Yes, it's amusing. Yeah. Have you
caught you had a you had a similar story? Well, not a tearing a door off a car, but like when you started the Harris Improv, just celebrated its 15th year.
Yeah.
And I heard a great story about there it is right there. There you are on stage.
That's Harris Improv, right?
Yeah. Now you the first night. There was a story about the first night with Wendy.
The first night we were opening, and Wendy Liebman, I think it was a middle act, that's how long ago it was,
I'm
not sure. And there was a fire in the hotel, and they canceled the show. And we were going to do two shows that night, and I figured we're done. So I took my wife, Alex, and Wendy, and a few other guys, and we went across the street to Spargo. At Caesars, yeah.
And so there was going to be no show.
Yeah, we figured, no first show.
Anyway. Fire, no first
no
show.
No second show.
There's Wendy there.
Lovely Wendy. And we're sitting there eating, we're drinking champagne, and another comic comes in who didn't work for me. What was his name? Anyway. And he says, well, I'll see you at the second show. I said, I'll see you at the show. I said, there's no show. He said, yes, there is. I just came from the hotel. It was just a grease fire in the elevator, and they contained it, and there's no problem. There'll be a second show. I said, get the champagne out of here. We got to go to work. We had a fun show that night.
Oh, of course, right? Just racing over there. But that's the thing with comedy is it's such, no matter what comedy club I ever, go to, if it's an improv here or improv across the country, I always say comedy is like a fraternity. It's like no other art, actors and musicians, they have it, but comedy, it's like this universal fraternity that, you get together with three people and there's a fire, yet you still put the show on, or you're in the middle of Montana.
I'd rather have champagne.
Yeah.
There's a fire. But when I first moved out here in 1974, to open in 75, I called up Jay Leno, whom I used to manage back in New York, and I said, Jay, I'm a club owner without any money. I need a car out here. I didn't need one in New York. Help me get something.
Really?
Jay is a car maven.
Right.
So Jay says, let me look, and a week later he says, I got the car for you out in Pasadena. It's a 69 four-door Cadillac with a big fence, 12,000 miles. Well, that was great. So... I'm sorry, did I say 69? 1959. And so we go out to look at the car, and it's beautiful. It's in great shape. And the young man who was selling it, his father owned Whammo, the hula hoop thing.
Oh, wow.
And the kid says, see our house back there? 100 years old. And Jay just bites his tongue, and we drive away. And Jay says, my parents, who are, say, lower middle class economically, live in a home that's 300 years old, big deal. Anyway, the car was great, and I was parked on Melrose Avenue in front of the club one night, and a car came by and swiped it.
Really?
And I was heartbroken, and I called the police, and the policeman comes to make a report, and at the time, Andy Kaufman was doing he did three of them. They were called Midnight Snacks. And he did a takeoff on a talk show, and he had a riser on the on the stage, and his chair was on the riser, and everyone else's chairs were on the stage, and they had to look up to Jay like this.
To
Andy doing, what would become of Jay. Anyway, and it was hilarious. And he had a has-been corner. And for the first 2 weeks, he had on ex-waitresses of ours, whom he used to wrestle with, and they would come up with these fantastic stories. One was Miss America, and instead of going to college, she chose the money, and then she got married, and the guy took all her money, and then she starts weeping. She has two children, and that's her husband. The last guy to come up, the third week, was a friend of his who was taping the shows for him, very casually. And he's now the has-been, and he was a real has-been, and his name is Richard Boehmer, who was the lead in West Side Story, the movie.
Oh, right? Wow.
And Andy says, "How's it feeling?" He holds up an album cover, mm-hmm. right, of West Side Story. "How's it feel to be a has-been?" And Richard says, "I'm not a has-been." He says, "You haven't done anything since West Side Story 15 years ago." And Richard says, "Andy, when you do a movie as important as West Side Story, you have to pick and choose your next episode, next movie, very carefully." And so Andy says, "Well, would you sing for us?" He says, "Sure." He says, "You know, that's why they ruined the movie." He says, "Because they dubbed my voice," Richard Bamer says.
Right.
And he starts singing, and he purposely cracks his voice singing Maria. And he walks off crying, saying, "Maybe I am a has-been." And I'm up in my office. We'd have a little window overlooking the stage, right. And the cop and I, we're wetting our pants. We're hysterical. My poor car is destroyed. He's supposed to take a report. And we're watching Richard Bamer, there he is, singing Maria. Andy, of course, was so special. Was he still around when you started working at the club?
When I started working, was he still around? No, he died in...
Yeah, of course.
Now, when he came in, though, to the club to interview you, I heard he interviewed as Latka.
You
thought that's who he was.
Oh, you mean when I first met him?
When you first met him.
Yes, yes. He was recommended to me back in New York City by a guy who owned a club in... coffee house in Great Neck, where Andy lived. Mm-hmm. And he said, "You got to see this guy." And I don't ask questions. I said, "Fine, if you recommend him, send him in, tell him to come in at 11 o'clock, which is a quiet time for us." He shows up. He says, "How do you do?" He says, "My name is Andy Kaufman. And where are you from, kid?" "I am from a small island in the Caspian Sea." Well, I didn't know there were no islands in the Caspian Sea. Okay. And so he gets up and he's doing his act as the foreign man. And people are laughing sort of nervously, as I am.
Right.
Little twitters, those kind of. Yeah. And then he does his Elvis impression. And, you know, it's spot on. And I say, "Well, I was in Japan. I heard Japanese women singing American songs." They were right on.
There's the idea right there.
Yeah. But they couldn't speak English. They could just sing it. So that's something what Andy is doing,
right.
This person. And then when he finishes, "Well, thank you very much. I knew I had been had." And I became a lifelong devotee of Andy. You know.
And you were obviously in the movie, Man on the Moon.
Yes.
In a similar scene, watching in the club.
Mm-hmm.
And Jim Carrey
was just phenomenal.
Just embodied him.
Yeah. He. One day I came onto the set and I said to the makeup girl, "Have you seen Jim yet?" And she says, "No, I've seen Andy." He went into character just like Andy did.
I heard that on set he really most of the time stayed in Andy because it really helped him become the character.
Yeah.
Was it hard during the movie? I mean, for you, obviously were close with
Andy,
relive it all.
There were a few touching moments. Actually, now that I think of it, when we did Man on the Moon.
I got a great picture right here. Can we get a little zoom on that?
Zoom
kids?
On this, as they say in the biz. This is Danny DeVito.
There's
this Danny. Is Danny DeVito, who played George Shapiro, Andy's manager.
Right.
Also managed another kid named. Seinfeld? Oh, Seinfeld? Jerry Seinfeld. Yeah,
who?
Right. Yeah.
Who?
And that's me, of course, and that's Jim Carrey. And Paul Giamatti over here, who has gone on to great stuff. He played Bob Zamuda.
Bob Zamuda, yeah.
Andy's friend and foil many times. So, he's still doing... what was the guy's name? Tony Clifton.
Tony Clifton. Yeah.
Tony Clifton.
Oh, that's just so great.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Now, you mentioned, obviously, I started at the Improv. Now, I started the Improv running the room as you've had a lot of famous people that people don't realize were working your door. You know, I mean, in New York, definitely, and even in L.A., you had, was Keenan worked your
Keenan
door?
Keenan Wayans, Joe Piscopo.
Piscopo.
Of course, Danny Aiello, who's one of my favorite doormen, the biggest guy in the world, but a real sweetheart.
I'll never forget about Aiello. You did this amazing tribute at the Improv to Dangerfield. And Aiello was sitting in the hallway, and he was going to go on stage, and he was so nervous. And I was like, oh, you're Danny Aiello. You're like, why are you nervous? And he's like, oh, I don't, you guys do this live thing with the funny. He's like, I do 6-7 takes.
Oh, he used to, you know, Danny started at the club. I hired him as a bouncer. He was out of work. Oh, there's Joe Piscopo. Right, handsome Joe. But Danny was, I hired him because I found him in the park, Central Park, playing softball, and we had a team in the Broadway Show League, so he's a wonderful athlete. So I hired him as a doorman, and you know, I paid him $190 a week, which was a fortune, really, because more money than I was making at the time, and he never forgot that. And whenever he does an interview, he mentions, you know, his, you know, start at the Improv and how he worked there. But he used to do backup singing for Bob Klein. Bob would improvise a song.
Really?
And he, Danny, Marvin Braverman, do you know Marvin?
No, no, Marvin.
Liz Torres, mm-hmm. among others, were the backup singers. And it was just hilarious.
Wow. We have a question from the internet. Oh.
What star have you enjoyed meeting most?
Oh, what is one of the stars that you've enjoyed meeting most?
Which, well, that's...
that's a hard one because there's so many.
No, it's not.
No?
Because, I mean, the one night at the club in New York, I mean here, out here, we had been open a couple of years, and one of my waitresses came up and she says, aren't you crazy about Barbara Streisand? I said, yeah, she's my favorite performer. Why? Well, she's just leaving. I says, what? Yeah, she's been inside. She's in the lobby talking to Jimmy Walker. So I go running out, and Jimmy says goodbye, and I go over and I introduce myself to her, and I said, Budd Friedman, I own the Improv, and big fan, and all that crap. And she says, the Improv, she says, why does that name sound familiar? I said, well, we've been open in New York for over 10 years now. We've opened here just last year. And a lot of people, you know, have started with me, like Jimmy Walker, who we were talking to, Freddie Prinze, Barbara Streisand. And I meant to say, and she goes, oh, using my name in vain, are we? And she was delightful. I said, well, now I said, no, I'm saying Bette Midler, you know. I'm sorry, I meant to say Bette Midler. And she was very gracious. She was just terrific.
Yeah. That's the great thing about the Improv, though, is I was blessed to come in to the there's Bette right there.
Yeah, there's
which
Bette.
You actually, before I get to what I was going to say, you actually managed
Bette. I managed
you helped,
Bette.
You helped really launch her to
I
the Tonight
got
Show,
her
really.
Five Tonight shows, five Merv Griffin shows, five David Frost shows, her first really professional gig outside the Continental Bass at Mr. Kelly's. Hmm. Jackie Vernon, I'm sure you know, Jackie sure. Vernon was this wonderful rotund comedian who was very successful, and one of the most gracious men in the business I've ever known.
Yeah,
she stole the show from him. She got reviews like you couldn't believe in Chicago. He couldn't have been prouder.
Oh, that's nice.
And then years later, we did a show at the Frontier Hotel. We replaced Siegfried and Roy for a month while he went on vacation. And I had Jackie Vernon, Shelley Berman, Fred Willard, and at one point Bill Maher, and there he is, Jackie Vernon, yeah. And Pam Madison. Do you know Pam?
Yeah, I know Pam.
So Pam was a singing impressionist. And the second night, Jackie, even though he's closing the show, is sitting backstage. And I'm waiting there to go on. I'm emceeing, and Jackie says, did you see the newspaper review? I said, no, I didn't. Sends a guy out to get the paper. And he opens the review, and he hands it to me just in the morning. He says, read this. And I go out on stage, and the review says, Budd Friedman opened the Improv at the Frontier last night with a lineup that included Jackie Vernon. And then he went on and did 3.5 paragraphs on how great Pam Madison was. This is what Jackie Vernon wanted me to read.
Right,
that's
right.
The kind of man he was. Right. And then, you know, also on the show was Jackie Vernon and Shelley Brown. He was just always so gracious, so
well, that's warm. The thing, that's what I was going to get to, was I was so blessed to come into the Improv when I did, because it was, you know, the 80s were a certain time for comedy, the 90s were a certain time for comedy, but I was able to come in at the tail end of a time where I was just so welcomed. The Improv was like, I always said, was the Cheers for comics, you know? Comics would come from far and wide, from old and young, and show up and just jump on stage or mess around, or you'd get to see, you know, back in the day, Kaufman, you'd get to see David Cross jump on stage, you know, just, you know, yell in the back while somebody was doing something, but it was always warm, and comics were always very supportive of each other.
They still are.
No, totally.
Yeah.
Question from the internet.
Yes, yes, yes. What other beautiful women have you met at the Improv?
What
other beautiful? Well, I met the most beautiful woman in the world at the Improv.
Here it comes.
Who became my wife.
There you go.
And is my
Somebody's
wife.
Somebody's getting lucky today.
Yeah. And my
Alex.
Wife, Alexandria, and I Hi, just Alex. Celebrate, I mean, just celebrate. We've been celebrating our 30th anniversary in May. So,
oh, that's nice.
You know, that's almost a felony here in Hollywood. That's Joanne Astro's line, by the way.
Is it?
I gotta give credit in case they see this. But yes, I met my wife. She was introduced to me by a mutual friend, and can't be lucky. But
it was a
the
fix
other
up?
Beautiful woman, huh?
It was a fix-up?
No, just a casual introduction.
Just a casual introduction,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, it wasn't casual for me. It was for Alex. But I did have the great pleasure of meeting Raquel Welch.
There you go.
A few times at the Improv. She was there for, we were doing our, I think our 15th anniversary in, can we go back to that picture for a moment?
Yeah.
15th anniversary in L.A. We had a party, and mm-hmm. I had this great press agent in New York, whom I lost in my divorce, because he was handling the L.A. too. She, my ex-wife
got him. You lost your press agent?
Yeah. And so I had to call him up. I needed a press agent, and he got me a man named Stanley Black, Stanley Cowan, who was Warren Cowan's brother. Mm-hmm. But he was a black sheep of the family, and he was a little old-fashioned. And for celebrities, he brought in Georgie Jessel and what's his name? Rudy Valli. Well, I could have gotten Rudy Valli, no worries. So it wasn't a very, you know, but Raquel also. And so Alex and I were just living together at the time. And she wasn't at the club yet. She was coming later. And I called because Georgie Jessel showed up with all these medals. I said, honey, get my medal. She brings it down. And that medal you saw on my lapel was from the Bronx. When I lived in the Bronx, Lowe's 167th Street had a Tarzan movie playing, so they had a swimming contest. Who's that?
Oh, is it George?
Who?
It said that it was
Georgie. Oh, wrong picture.
Oh, okay. That's my aunt and uncle from Poland. But anyway, I won this swimming medal when I was 16.
Oh.
It was called Tarzan Swim Me.
Oh, that's so awesome.
So I had to show up something for Georgie Jessel.
Showed up with your swimming medal.
Yes.
Awesome. And proudly, I'm sure you did.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Of course you did.
Absolutely,
of course you did.
Yeah.
Oh, that's so great.
Yes.
Oh, we got another picture here.
Speaking of Rudy Valli.
There we go.
Back in New York, we did Look Magazine, which doesn't exist anymore,
mm-hmm.
did a... what do you call it? A feature story on what the performers do in between shows on Wednesday and Saturday matinees. So I set it up to have Rudy Valli, Michelle Lee, the stars of, and Bobby Moss, the stars of How to Succeed in Business, mm-hmm. come in
yeah.
and eat and see. Rudy, you see, is in a tuxedo. This is at 5 o'clock in the afternoon.
Oh, great picture.
And we also had. In our group, because I loaded it in, I wanted to be in Look Magazine, we had the dog from Oliver eating in his own little bowl. Right? I thought, we didn't make the cut. We never made it to the magazine.
Oh, that's great. The stories you tell. You're watching Actors E here at ActorsEntertainment.com. And here's Anna Shell ready to tell us about a unique, one-of-a-kind gift shop at Artisora.com. So check it out. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Anna Shell Ray, here to share with you a terrific online gift store, Artisora.com. Artisora is an online art colony of completely original and absolutely affordable gifts and fine art. Artisora is particularly fun because it includes many unique and one-of-a-kind gifts, cards, and wall art that you can't get anywhere else. For example, in the gift section, Artist Store carries beautiful apparel art ties. Yes, art ties! Ties hand decorated with jewelry, fringe, beads, and all sorts of stuff. Animal art ties, art deco ties, music ties, you name it! And best of all, the ties are for both men and women and can be worn well with a pair of jeans or in a tux. Artist Store also has inspirational corporate jungle posters. Joe Sabatino likes the poster of the hippo. He put it on his refrigerator to remind him of what not to look like. Yes, clown art, custom airbrushed t-shirts, hand-knit scarves, photography, handmade decorated soaps, and more, all on one site, artiststore.com. I especially enjoy the artwork by Brennan's section of Artist Store. Brennan offers his artwork on note cards, mugs, and wall art, whether it's cocktail ladies, a smoking clown, or Ben and Becky's art for a child's room. Brennan's unique watercolor or pen and ink art will be perfect for the occasion. And when you use the discount code ActorsReporter at checkout, you'll get 10% off your entire Artist Store order. ArtistStore.com. That's spelled A-R-T-I-S-T-O-R. That's A-R-T-I-S-T-O-R. Check it out. You'll be glad you did. ArtistStore.com for all your unique gift needs. Hi.
And we're back. And everybody, definitely check out ArtistStore.com. Here's some storyboard art by Brennan, which we always love. We love the work these guys do because it's interesting and it's different. It's the kind of place you go to get a gift, and you'll seem neat instead of going to Target and getting a gift. We're here with Budd Friedman, and which is such a pleasure for me, Budd. It really is, because every comics, they all have their stories of how they started, and for me, we all wanted to sit at your table at the Improv, and the day you sat at Budd, the day Budd invited you with champagne over to his table, you knew you had arrived. And to me and everyone, you've always been so gracious, and I think that's why the Improv is what it is, why it is such a home and love, and the way people talk about it. Because everybody, just always feels great there. And then, I can't thank you enough. Now, speaking of a lot of comics, we see them, we had A&E's evening at the Improv, and now there's things like Comic Relief and, all over the place, all these comics. I wanted to talk about Oprah for a second because...
Talk about comedy.
Oh,
talk about funny women.
Yeah, talk about... There she is right there. But she's leaving this year, and she did a very nice thing at the Improv about Comic Relief.
She did... I think it was the first year of this Comic Relief. She did the whole segment
and this
from
was then,
the
yes?
Improv with Robin Williams and who's not... Billy Crystal and... who else? Whoopi Goldberg, who are not shown in that picture, but they were all there, and they did the full Oprah show, all about Comic Relief and these people from the Improv. We've also done a lot of segments for the Jerry Lewis Telethon, where they would come in and tape 10 comics, and then there's Whoopi, and they would tape 10 comics. And then feed them into the show.
Right.
Funny story about Whoopi. My wife Alexandria. One of the wonderful attributes about her was, besides her beauty, intelligent wit.
He's good.
She's not in the business.
Yeah.
I love that. So the first night I was smitten with her, completely smitten. We're at the Improv. So our first date. Next night we go to the Improv. Price was right for me, and I always got a good table, and we go in, and we're sitting watching the show, and this comic goes on, and she says, I think I can do that, when he finished. I said, what? Well, he seems to be having so much fun, I think I could do that. I said, oh, boy. I said, We go back the next night. Fate would have it, the same comic is on again. When he finishes, she says, no, I don't think I can do that. It was Robin Williams. She saw Robin carrying on as they said, oh, look how much fun he's having. I can do that.
I did the same thing. I was watching Seinfeld one night, and he was doing, on a Tuesday night, he was, bombing. And George Wallace was sitting there, and I was like, see, I could do that. And George Wallace goes, no, see, that's what makes him amazing. Even though he's on NBC and that he's still willing to come work on his material. And that's what just makes him fabulous.
Yeah, there's
Seinfeld right there.
There's people are always, once they become a comic, their whole personality changes. And there was a kid that used to come in the club in New York. He was a cab driver, nice looking boy. And he'd come in with his dates. I was very happy to see him. He's always very pleasant, very nice. And then one day he says, I think I'm going to become a comic. And I said, oh, really? You should really? Let's stay friends, you know. And he was the first one that I remember doing this transition. And he starts to go up, and he's terrible. And then he says to me, I'm funnier than Freddie Prinze. I'm funnier than Jimmy Walker, who are relatively unknown working out at the time. And then he says, makes the cardinal mistake. He says, I'm funnier than Robert Klein. And I grab him and I throw him through the door, because Robert Klein was the king then.
Wow.
He was the absolute king of the improv. And, you know, that was just sheer insanity. So I didn't want to take any chances. I had to get this guy out of there. But the people do change when they become comedians. Not you, Brett. You're always obnoxious.
Going to walk away from that one because I still want to work at your club. Now, who are some guys that you like nowadays? You know, there's so many great comedians out there, and you are responsible for discovering so many of them. I know there's like Todd Glass out there now. You know, you got Ferrara's been working the circuit forever. Are there some that you particularly love?
Well,
You think they're going to pop.
You mentioned, and Jeremy Hotz, I always enjoy. David Feldman, although he's mostly writing now. Mm-hmm. And of course, lovely Wendy Liebman.
Yes.
You know, Howie Knave just got married.
Did he?
Our manager up in Tahoe at the Improv there. And he was also our MC, and so Rocky Laporte was his best man.
Oh wow!
And Wendy was a maid of honor or something. He was quite comic sweating.
You know, there's David right there.
Yeah, David Feldman.
Love David. He's so funny.
I remember years when I first met Alex. As a matter of fact, it was 1980, and in 1979 we had the fire. The whole back room burned mm-hmm. down. Things were not good financially. I was going to sell the club and go into real estate, because I'd done very well with selling houses and all. But, you know, my homes. But who didn't in those days? But I didn't know about that. You know, I thought it was me. So anyway, my wife talked me out of it, and I stayed at the Improv. It was a point of that story, but we have a caller, I see.
real quick, before we get to the caller, it's true that the guys got together, though, after the fire to do a fundraiser, didn't they?
Oh, yeah, sure.
Robin
gave me one night, and Andy gave me one night. Well, and you know, they're both huge stars. We sold out, I think, $50 a ticket, maybe $75, and I was able to put money into the bank and get me started because we were so lean. We took the dining room in the front and made it into a showroom, and we had 74 seats, exactly what I started with in New York. And we still got great shows, but couldn't make any money.
You know, yeah. So.
And it took 9 months to get it reopened.
Wow. Well, it's just great that everybody came together to keep the club up. We have a question from
Do you like being an actor?
Oh, that's a great question.
Me.
Do you like being an actor?
I'm the biggest ham in the world. As
you?
A matter of fact.
Not at all.
The last segment I did was,
Look at that.
That's acting. That's acting. Actually, that was.
There's no acting involved at all.
This is Bob Fosse's Star 80.
Uh-huh.
And I had just become involved with Alexandria. And Alex is a very classy lady, and she was trying to, and she has somewhat upgraded my outlook on life and the way I behave and so forth. And when I heard about this part that they wanted me to do in the movie after I got the auditions on, I said, I don't know, Alex is going to be furious with me, right? And I'm very skeptical, and I go into the rehearsal hall, and there's Bob Fosse running the girls through, and he's playing me, you know, doing what I'm going to do. And I'm saying, well, if Bob Fosse can do it, hell's bells, I can do it. So, and Alex didn't mind at all. It was just a movie. But I love doing movies.
Yeah.
I did an episode of 30 Rock, the other one that failed.
From the Sun?
Huh? Sunset Studio.
Sunset 4? Well, yeah, about SNL. I can't remember either. Sunset, the Sunset Strip, Studio 40.
Studio something.
Studio Sunset, something at the something strip, yeah, no. Well, which was basically SNL behind the scenes.
Written by this great writer.
Soderbergh.
No.
Didn't Soderbergh do it?
No.
No?
See, they did West Wing.
Yes. Anyways. And there's this legend, this writer, this relatively young man, sitting at the bar when I come in about 7 in the morning. And I'm introduced to him, and he says, "Thank you so much for allowing us to shoot here. It's really an honor for us." He says, "You're a legend," and this, and my head is like this. I, holy mackerel, you know. And so it was a 16-hour day. And at the end of the day, I was doing this scene with a young man, an older man. I'm talking at the bar, and in walks the stars. It was, God, it's a great day. Anyway, and my
job was Matt Perry.
Matt Perry and...
Who's the comic?
The black comic.
Our memories are shot today.
Yeah. Anyway, so I have to get up from the and then go to the bar and read them.
There they are, right there. Studio 60 on the Sunset Strip.
Yes, okay. And so I've done the take, 15 takes, you know, at least. And I'm talking to these two guys. So at the end of the shoot, I said, "Thanks, boy. I think I see mini series for us, you know, because you had to do it so many times." And they laughed at him. So, meanwhile, I got this swollen head from come up with this guy's name, this wonderful writer who did
West Wing.
Who?
Did you West Wing?
Yes,
as well? West Wing. Right. Yes. Oh. Okay. So anyway, free pass to the improv. Whoever comes up with it first.
Right, there you go. There you go. Free pass to the improv on the internet. First person to come up with it.
So
there you go.
We finished the day, and I'm going out to get my car, and the young man comes up to me, and he said, "Gee, that was fun." I said, "Yes, it was." He says, "I'm sorry, I didn't get your name."
That's awesome.
Well, there goes my swollen head.
That's awesome.
So 2 months later, Alex and I are in New York.
Aaron Sorkin.
There we go.
2 months later, we're in New York, and my good friend Aaron Sorkin is previewing his new Broadway show called Farnham, and it was about the birth of television. And I figured he'd be there, you know. So when we got up at intermission, I looked in the back of the room, and sure enough, there he is. So I go over and I go, you know, he says, "My favorite actor." Yes, I love to act.
Any favorite directors?
Oh, any favorite directors you've worked with?
Oh, yes. I worked, as I said, I had the great pleasure working with Bob Fosse in Star 80, and he was phenomenal. Wow. I went in for a role of a nightclub owner, MC, big stretch. And
I
knew Bob vaguely. I'd met him a few times. It's a small part. He sits me down and he talks to me for 15 minutes, just this, that, and the other thing. I do my reading. He says, try it this way. Okay, fine. So he says, "You'll hear from us." So I get a call. They want me to come back to read again. So in the meantime, a mutual friend of Alex's, mine, a girl named Sis Rundell, who was a Rams cheerleader. There's
Bob right there.
Fosse.
That's Bob right there.
And Sis is a friend of Fosse's. And Sis says to me, "Listen, Bob loves improvising. Don't worry about the script. And he loves props." Mm-hmm. I said, "Okay." So I walk in the next day, and I got a cigar in my mouth, and I'm eating a sandwich. And I'm saying the first line of the script is, "So you're the guy that wants to talk about Dorothy Stratton." And he says, "Bud, how are you? Come on, sit down." I put down my sandwich and my cigar. We talk another 20 minutes, doing it, reading this way, doing it that way. When I finish, says, "Thanks very much. That's terrific. Well, you're going to use your." And I get up to go, and I start to walk out. And he says, "Bud, you forgot your sandwich and your cigar." I said, "Bob, they were props." And he fell over laughing. He didn't even realize it.
That's great.
That was very funny. But then I worked with, of course, Milos Forman in the Andy Kaufman movie, Man on the Moon. And he was a dream, boy.
What was that like, you know, with him? Was he methodical about it? Did he kind of just let you fall into it, play? You know, what was it like working with him?
He's there's and then my other favorite director, Larry Cohn, who is wanted to be a comic, then wrote for comics, and he came in the Improv New York and became best friends, and he's done hundreds of movies where he's wrote, produced, and directed, And a number of them were comedies, including Full Moon High with a young Adam Arkin, among others, and old comics you would know up the gazoo.
Yeah, yeah.
And I booked them all. I became his comedy technical director. But I did another movie for Harry Hurwitz called, two movies for him. One was called Honeymoon Hotel.
Oh, yeah.
And I played a John, and the hooker was Fran Drescher.
Oh, no way.
And I get thrown out of the hotel. I'm discovered with my boxer shorts on with Fran there by two bellhops, the Funny Boys, who are no longer comics, but very successful producers.
Oh, I got to get a copy of that.
Yeah.
We have another question for the internet.
Identify some of our pictures that we have.
You know, we have a bunch of great pictures that we you brought in. You want to check them out?
This is, of course, George...
George Burns.
George Burns, Terry Garr, and Sandra Bernhardt.
Oh, wow, that is
from,
Sandra.
The Jerry Lewis movie and George Burns movie. What the hell was it called again?
God something?
Pardon?
God? Or God? I'm God? Or
no, 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 no. This was the... no, what was your... Oh, George wasn't in the movie. I'm sorry. It was Jerry Lewis, Sandra, and
Terry Garr.
And Bobby De Niro. And they did this...
Oh, the King of the... King of Comedy.
King of Comedy.
Wow,
and,
what a great movie that was.
They had the opening night party. The 20th Century calls up to me, I'm opening our party at the club. I said, well, you got to get a King of Comedy. What do you mean? Well, Milton Berle, George Burns, can you get him? I said, yes, yeah. I think so. I call up George Burns' manager, Irving Fine. I said, Irving, 500 comics have voted George King of Comedy. They want to present him. And he says, make it 5,000 and we'll be there. I said, 5,000 comics. George was just terrific. And the other picture was
Jack Lemmon right there.
Jack Lemmon. We have a traffic school at the Improv in Melrose. And if you get a traffic ticket in California, you can go to traffic school.
Right.
And we have these wonderful comics teaching the class. I just took it myself just last month. Enjoyed it immensely. But he was in the class, and somebody was doing a story on the Improv. I forgot. And a photographer was coming shooting. And I said, would you mind taking a picture with me? He said, not at all. So if you're going to take a picture of me, boom, it's a snap, and we're out of there.
Right.
This guy, well, get the lighting. We were up there for a half an hour.
No.
Jack never said a word. Oh. He was so nice and so gracious.
That's nice. Well, before we go, I want to make sure everybody knows you are doing iJokeTV.tv.
iJoke.tv. We have where you can upload your own joke.
Anyone can.
Anyone can.
Not just comics.
Anyone.
Anybody
yes,
can go check out the site. And
yeah.
Just
it's
put up a joke. And yeah, it's a lot of fun. It's a
you
great
You may get thing. Discovered.
Yes.
No one has yet, but you know, your time may come.
By this guy.
And the website?
Improv.com.
Improv.com.
And Facebook under the same name.
Yes.
And there it is.
There it is.
Steve Byrne,
and it's great. I love the new website because you really can, no matter where you are, if it's you know, New York to Miami, you can just find the local clubs who's
playing.
Yeah,
we have 22 clubs, and you can just click on to anyone there.
There's Tommy Davidson right there.
Chicago, I think.
And
yeah, you click on and get there without any problem.
Thanks for coming, bud.
Thanks.
It's my pleasure.
Thank you for coming.
Well, thank God. Well, I told you. It's hard getting here, but it's worth it. Thank you, everybody, for watching, of course, here on Actor Z. We are here every Monday through Friday, 10 a.m. Hollywood time. And check us out on Monday on Actor Z. No, that's tomorrow is Max.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. They're doing my cue cards well today. Tomorrow, I'm going to be interviewing Max Worthington, the founder of the Los Angeles Comedy Awards. That's going to be a lot of fun. Definitely check that out, everybody. And stay tuned for our award-winning animation. Here you go, bud. That's for you.
Oh, you're kidding.
Yes, we'd like to give you a Telly Award.
Wow.
Of course, we won the Telly Award for our award-winning animation from And Now Productions and Pepper J Productions. So I have
And
to
Now Media.
Oh, thank the Academy.
I knew as soon as I gave it to him, I wasn't going to get it back.
And Now Media.
And Now Media and Pepper J Productions for all their great work. Thank you, everybody. See you tomorrow.
Thank you.
Gosh, hey, big Hollywood starlet that just happens to be walking by.
Yes?
I'm not from around here, but I want to be an actress just like you. What do I need to know?
Kid, let me tell you. Whether you're a seasoned pro or a naive newbie like you, there's one thing you need to know to get my first job. I lived in a slum, beat out 50 other girls to play a drunk bum.
I cried.
My first agent charged me 30%.
Thanks.
Working three jobs and I couldn't pay rent. But I'm an actor.
She's an actor.
A shark gnawed my leg on a B film in Sydney. To pay for the stitches, I sold my left kidney. I finally made a union, their rules were complex. Their piles of paperwork fogged up my specs. But I'm an actor.
She's an actor.
I'm an actor. Well, that's rather disturbing, but what's the one thing I need to know? Don't listen to the critics. Don't follow all the tabs. Forget that sleazy photog and the agent that's got crabs. Go to Actors Reporter.
Actors Reporter.
ActorsReporter.com. Learn the tricks and the secrets without all the sweat. An info-packed one-stop shop. It's free and on the net. Actors Reporter.
Actors Reporter.
ActorsReporter.com.
How can they help her?
Career cues, union news, makeup woes, advice from pros, insurance tips, choosing scripts, everything at your fingertips. Actors Reporter.
Actors Reporter.
Actors Reporter. Dad, call.
I just got a call back.
I'm Mary Jo Gruber. Thanks for joining us on Actor Z Live Chat Show. I'm just one of your Actor Z hosts, but as you can see, I'm also the Actor Z Live video editor, which means that I'm here, even when you don't see me. Actor Z is here to chat with you Monday through Friday at 10 a.m. Pacific Standard Time, or Hollywood time, as I like to call it. Our guests include actors, directors, producers, writers, singers, comics, and others that are all in the entertainment industry. You can see previous shows at www.actorsentertainment.com, and be sure to check out our guest index to find your favorite celebrities. See you next time. I'm working.